Let's now talk to Department of Health spokesperson, Assistant Secretary Albert Domingo. Assistant Secretary Domingo, welcome to Top Story.
Thank you so much, Stanley. Glad to be back here.
All right, it's good to have you here again. Now, the latest casualty attributed, of course, to vaping significantly helps build a case now against the use of vaping. What moves are now happening to the campaign against open or maybe even freer access to these products?
Exactly. I like how you use the word case, because this is a case report published in an international journal. Many of the critics of this particular report were saying maybe we did not ascertain if the patient had any other condition, or maybe this is actually coming from a smoker. But I think I heard when you said in the intro to this report that the patient never did smoke. In his entire youth, up to the age of 20, when he started using vape, he never did smoke. So the argument that vapes are harm reduction devices falls on this particular case. And in the sense of epidemiology, and sad to say, this might just be the start of documentation. Okay. In epidemiology, the number of cases are counted, and you have from one case to a case series, until finally there's a series of cases with the sound data that will say there is indeed a very strong link. And this is the warning sign.
Okay, can you perhaps share with us some more details on the recent death of this young Filipino, 22 years old, started vaping 2 years ago, died of a heart attack, but had, you know, already had lung injuries detected prior to death. I mean, are these manifestations similar to the other deaths reported in other countries? Because for now, we just have one case here.
That's correct. There's just one case for now. And take note, Stanley, one detected case. It doesn't mean that there's just one on the list, that nothing else is happening. This particular patient had his lungs taken on CT scan, and there was a ground glass appearance, the same appearance that is actually seen when you have severe pneumonia in COVID-19. Okay. In other words, the lungs were really already gasping for air, and there was already a problem. But take note that the pathology in this particular patient is a heart attack. So more than the e-cigarette and the vape-associated lung injury, or the EVALI, which still happened in this patient, there is also the beginning association of vape use with cardiovascular pathology. Because as yesterday I was with other health experts, and they were explaining that they did observe that in a vape user, the arteries start narrowing. And in this particular patient, what is actually notable or sad is that in just 2 years, you have what takes decades in older people. You don't get actually the technical term is atherosclerosis, where you have your arteries being blocked by cholesterol deposits. Yeah. Normally, these are patients in their 60s, 70s, 80s. You have a 22-year-old with just 2 years history. It's really
bad. Which
is
ridiculous, actually, when you think about the speed at which the deterioration happened. Now, do we have enough cases to say we can now establish at least a pattern, or you can say for certain that this is the textbook symptoms, at least, of any vape-related lung injuries and deaths?
We do have a case definition of what EVALI is. And the challenge here, Stanley, is before you can classify a case as EVALI, you have to complete what you call is a respiratory panel. What is a respiratory panel? Remember, for COVID, we used to have, or we still do up to now, the RT-PCR, which costs roughly around now 3,000 pesos. But in a respiratory panel, you test for maybe around 8 to 10 other viruses. So multiply the cost of a 3,000 times 8 at least. So you're going to get, 24,000 pesos. So there might be a cost barrier to the proper recording of EVALI cases. But zooming out from that, Stanley, the real issue here is, do we wait for sufficient data before we start saying that there is a problem? In formal epidemiology, and this is probably what the industry experts will say, some of whom sadly are also my fellow doctors, they will say, you don't have enough data. Well, you know what? When smoking was first declared as a carcinogen, and when cigarette smoke was declared, it was already after a decade or two, and there were so many deaths already. Yeah. It takes a lot of deaths for epidemiology to record. Do we wait for that? That is the question.
All right. So there is a way of testing. I mean, I'm sure a lot of individuals there, and even parents, worried about their children or the young children getting into vaping. Is there a way for these people to get tested now?
Well, the good news is you don't need a test per se. As long as you have a history of not having any other substance use, the very, what do they say in Latin, res ipsa loquitur, the fact that you're using a vape is already enough to say that you are bound to get evali when it comes to this particular scourge. So the best thing to do here is if you need to be diagnosed, yes, please see your doctor. The doctors are particularly the pulmonologist, the pediatric pulmonologist. Sad to say, it has to be a pediatric pulmonologist because of the age band. They will be able to diagnose what your lung function is, how are your lungs. I just wanted to emphasize that point, Stanley. Normally, yesterday it was so striking. The internists were saying they used to be the only ones to see chronic obstructive pulmonary disease patients. The patients, the lolos and the lolas, the grandparents who you would hook on to oxygen masks. Now you have kids who are in their late 20s because of the damage caused by smoking and vape. Their lung capacity is diminished. And short of having a lung transplant, which is not a common thing to do, they will be hooked onto an oxygen tank for the rest of their lives.
And that is unfortunate. Now, Asek Domingo, you know, this is something that, you know, we have to deal with and confront as a country. And I know that the Department of Health is actively campaigning against vaping, especially among minors. But this has to go beyond just a campaign. What can be done in terms of, you know, curtailing even the access to these vape products, especially for young people?
I would answer the question twofold. The Department of Health is still a health agency. And if we are asked point blank, if we want vaping, our answer is no, of course not. Mm-hmm. We want to ban this. But of course, we understand that it is a social call, it is a policy, and RA 11900 came to be. As you all say, we follow the law no matter how flawed it may be. So now that we have this vape law, the next part of the answer, apart from advocating for a better law, is number two. Let's look at how it's written, the way it is now. There is supposed to be a particular distance around 100 meters by which those who are selling vapes cannot sell to minors, particularly from schools, from malls, or in places where minors are frequented. And as with many things in Philippine law, and not only in Philippine law, but in law in general, it's in implementation. So we are hearing that the DTI has promised to strictly enforce its new mandate, which used to be the mandate of the DOH to regulate vapes. And together with the DTI, the DOH has been calling on the PNP. We did meet with the General Acorda when he was still the chief PNP. We understand that the top brass has already endorsed the matter to the successor. And someone really has to be arrested, those who are violating the law, no matter how flawed it is, the way it is written now.
Yes, it remains to be seen how policy will evolve, really. But the urgency of the situation is something that, you know, we may have to confront sooner than later. Again, Assistant Secretary Albert Domingo of the Department of Health, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon for this discussion.
Thank you so much, Stanley, and have a good night.